Hello, my name is Anton Smorodsky, and today I will do a short introduction into into framework for monitor and clean up cloud service providers, public cloud watcher. Let's start. First of all, a few words about myself. I am working in IT since 2005, using Linux as main tool for work and fun since 2007. Main areas of interest before joining SUSE was Java and automated testing, mainly in area of online retail stores. After joining SUSE, focus shifted to Perl, Python and testing of SLE and openSUSE. One of the areas is testing of SLE in public cloud. And currently my favorite distro is openSUSE Lib, so I'm installing it everywhere I can. We will start from stating the problem which Public Cloud Watcher is trying to solve, then switch to the tool itself going through its main features. Also, we will speak about internals of Public Cloud Watcher. Next, we will speak about HashiCorp Vault, what this tool generally for, and about our very specific use case of this tool. And we will discuss how we currently maintain running instance of Public Cloud Watcher, what setup we have done to keep it running, and don't worry about any potential environment breakage. Last topic will be about future plans for this project. At my daily work, one of the main things what I am doing is testing how SLE behaves as a virtual machine in different cloud service providers, Azure, AWS, and GCE at the moment. All testing related to public cloud providers is happening in OpenQA in automated way. I assume majority of people who attending openSUSE conferences know at least something about OpenQA. For those who don't know or want to know more, I will recommend to visit open.qa or find some nice talks about OpenQA in previous conferences. I am sure that there were more than one talk like this. But let's get back to our main topic. So OpenQA uploading SLE image into dedicated cloud, then creating VM using this image and then running some testing against it. And after that, trying to clean up it after itself by deleting all created entities. Keep in mind that I said creating VM, but actually it's much more than that. Together with VM, every public cloud provider creating a lot of different entities, subnets, resource groups, disk and disk images, and etc., etc., etc. After successful test execution, we have logic which clean up all created entities. But of course, there is a plenty of options how things might go wrong. And regardless that we keep improving our code to do cleanup always, there is still room for some unexpected behavior from OpenQA side or from provider side, which would not allow to finish cleanup. All what I just described needs to be multiplied by diversity of public cloud providers. Like I said, VM creation usually means creation of some additional resources for this VM. And every cloud service provider has their own understanding what kind of resources will be created and how they will behave when you're trying to delete VM, because some of them will be automatically cleaned up, but others no, and there is a lot of different cases when this behavior differs. So basically, whenever something goes wrong in OpenQA, you not simply check that VM was deleted, but also check some other entities, and you need to keep in mind all differences of current provider. Currently, we're starting around 300 VMs daily in OpenQA in all three providers together. And this number will supposed to grow in nearest future. So obviously, there is no chance to keep all this in manual checkup. So we need to have some logic which will double check that our tests don't burn extra money. Also, it would be nice to have it outside OpenQA to not get into a trap that same bug which would invalidate cleanup in test level will do the same with our less chance cleanup logic. Also, it would be nice to have everything in one place to ease maintenance. Another problem, not directly related to what I just described, is coming from the fact that creation of VM requires credentials, which you need to bypass to the test in secure way and make sure that unattended person will not be able to use them. To address the first problem, we created Public Cloud Watcher. Project published in GitHub, so feel free to use it, learn from it, or contribute. It's written in Python using Django framework. Django was selected because of the cheap way to get web UI. Public Cloud Watcher monitor, clean up, and notify about leftovers in supported providers. Currently, we support three cloud service providers: Microsoft Azure, Amazon AWS, and Google Cloud Enterprise. For each provider, it's using native Python API bindings from provider to communicate with the cloud. Public Cloud Watcher is currently used by several teams inside our company. Each team has its own credentials to access clouds, its own images naming convention, and its own flows which images needs to be deleted and when. This is why in Public Cloud Watcher we have notion of namespaces, which allow us define these differences per team. Also, in some cases, public cloud accounts may be used not only by our open QA automation, but also some other people, and other automated workflows may create resources in the cloud. And we should not touch them, obviously. So we need to implement something smarter than delete everything older than X days to not interfere with work happening outside OpenQA. For this, we decided to use feature available in all three providers, ability to set tags on the resource. So when OpenQA creates VM in its VM, it settings two tags: OpenQA created by, which generally give a hint for Public Cloud Watcher that this VM should be monitored, and OpenQA TTL, which store amount of time after which Public Cloud Watcher may delete VM if OpenQA failed to do so after the test run. Internals of Public Cloud Watcher may be logically divided into several groups. One group represented by classes responsible for actual interaction with providers. It contains dedicated classes for each provider, which holds all provider-specific logic. Each class knows how to authenticate with certain provider, how to query for resources, and which resources actually needs to be queried. Another group responsible for actual VM cleanup. It has process which periodically loops over all providers in all defined namespaces and collect VMs according to tags, which I mentioned before. Then this VM serializes it into local SQLite database. Then it tries to delete VMs, leaving longer than TTL defined for them. And at the end, it sent email notification about VMs which was not deleted, so potential human involvement is needed. Also, there is a group responsible for cleanup of everything else. This group holds knowledge about specialties of every provider and what kind of additional entities are created together with VMs. To clean up them separately, because there is a lot of cases that after VM deletion, provider not delete these entities. All this cleanup and notification flows can be turned on and off on global level or per namespace. Such configuration stored in P PCW ini file, which Public Cloud Watcher reads on startup. Also, local SQL Lite database with cached list of VMs can be accessed via web interface, which allows to browse through list of VMs and do some basic search and manually trigger deletion of some VMs which was not yet cleaned up automatically. Now let's discuss second raised problem, credentials. After some discussions around the problem, we realized that to provide really secure flow to operate credentials within OpenQA, we would need to build pretty complex flow, which still might be broken easily. So we choose another path. We decided not to hide credentials at all, but define short TL and very limited permission set for them. To achieve this, we pick the project from company which created Terraform, which we also use quite a lot in the internals of our testing approach. The name of the project is Vault. Project page describes it as the following: secure, store, and tightly control access to tokens, passwords, certificates, encryption keys for protecting secrets and other sensitive data using UI, CLI, or HTTP API. Vault also has notion of namespaces, so it perfectly fits in our model. Another useful feature from Vault is ability to request temporary credentials from provider with certain set of permissions. Vault will keep track on these requested tokens and may request token deletion from the provider. Vault is used by OpenQA tests, so they have ability to create, delete VMs and Public Cloud Watcher, so it can query our accounts and delete leftovers in case there are any. We're using very basic Vault setup, which actually describe it as for testing purposes only and not using prod environments. We're not using any of fancy Vault storage types, which would give plenty of options where persistently store credentials. Instead, we're using RAM storage, which means 100% data loss in case of reboot, shutdown of Vault. But it's totally fine for us because we're generating temporary credentials anyway. Another not recommended way of using Vault is that we allowing not encrypted connections to Vault. But I would tell more about that part when I will describe our prod instance setup. So last but not least, let's speak about our prod instance where we have Public Cloud Watcher and Vault running. At the beginning, it was just random VM running somewhere. But over time, with more people start using it and more tests run rely on it, we start realizing that we need more stable ground. If Vault is down, no test will be able to finish because tests need Vault to get temporary credentials, which will allow create delete entities in the cloud. Also, if Public Cloud Watcher is down, tests are able to run, but there is a risk of getting big bills from Microsoft, Amazon, and Google. So at some point, we decided to move to state where we can recreate whole setup on clean machine within 10 minutes. There is plenty of options how one can back up some infrastructure in the code. Each one of these options has some pros and each one has some cons. Also, sometimes it's simply a matter of taste. After going through several different options, we end up on choosing containers as building material for our setup. The idea end up a separate repository which contains Docker files for Public Cloud Watcher, Vault and Nginx. Docker compose file which tie containers together, some bash scripts which automate everything what should be done outside Docker files, like installing Docker on the host, getting SUSE SSL certificate into host, which would be needed for communication with OpenQA. Check out of latest version of Public Cloud Watcher from GitHub, and etc. etc. Set of vault CLI commands, which do vault configuration from scratch. Set up all needed namespaces and upload root credentials for each cloud service provider in each namespace, which vault will later use to generate delete temporary credential on request. Public Cloud Watcher container based on Python 3 container. Whenever new image is built, it will take latest version of Public Cloud Watcher from GitHub and PCVW ini with details about which namespaces needs to be monitored and how. Also, container has attached storage to allow SQLite database with instances cache survive container recreation. Vault container is based on official container from HashiCorp and contains small config, which just defines in-mem storage and disables web interface of Vault. Most of business logic is in bash scripts with Vault CLI commands, which will do initial init of fresh Vault instance and set up all needed namespaces and secrets. So basically our approach that we are doing full automated install of both entities, Public Cloud Watcher and Vault, every time from scratch on clean container. But because it's fully automated, we basically can do it fast. And because it's based on stable container versions, we are in a safe mode that we don't getting so basically we have like reproducible builds at some point. To simplify Vault setup, but keep it secure, we introduce third container with Nginx. Nginx is playing a reverse proxy role here by encapsulating HTTP into HTTPS and a single entry point which broker requests to appropriate container, Public Cloud Watcher and Vault. This trick allows us to keep Vault unsecure from setting up point of view, but secure from usability point of view. This is how we work around what Vault is not recommending to do by allowing plain HTTP connections. Now let's speak about future plans. First, and in my opinion most important, we need to improve our code coverage with unit tests. Not that we don't have them at all, but let's say coverage is far away from 100%. Another problem which bothers me as a person who maintain Public Cloud Watcher is that whenever there is some issue in the cloud, for example, Azure changed API in non-backward compatible way, which already happened several times, I'm start getting email notification about exception every X minutes. From one side, I do want to be notified about the problem, so I would start acting as soon as possible. But on other hand, after I have read first email, I can skip next dozen, which would not say something new. So notification flow needs to become smarter and be aware whether it is some new problem which I need to be notified, or it is something what I have already seen. Also, currently web interface allow only manage VMs, but in fact, Public Cloud Watcher is cleaning a lot of other entities. It would be nice to see them in the web UI and have better understanding what actually cleaned and when. For now, to solve this problem, I usually grabbing log file of Public Cloud Watcher. That's all what I wanted to say. I will be happy to answer any additional questions during conference or any time after. And I would be even more happier if someone will consider using public cloud watcher together with us.